Six, after, what is the ladies' pumpkin day? What is that?
All things pumpkin.
All things pumpkin.
Hey, we're having an afternoon and crafts.
And crafts. Hmm. I might come for the all things pumpkin. Those are, they're gonna be pumpkin.
It said ladies.
Okay, do a little Mrs. Doubtfire to get some pumpkin roll there. We have our baptism service and our fellowship lunch on October 31st. If there's still somebody that needs to be baptized, just let us know and I'll get that pool up here. We'll fill it up, get it nice and toasty warm, and we will do that. And then something new that's coming up again, which we had it last year, is roller skating at Castle Skateland. That's October 25th from 7 to 9 p.m. So that's always a really good time. So make your way to Castle Skateland. And there's something else that I'm really excited about. So we had our vacation Bible school and we raised funds to buy a church van. Amen. And we raised just over $2,000 to buy a 15-passenger van, which $2,000, if we look at prices today, will do absolutely nothing for a 15-passenger van. You might be able to buy a tire with that. So some exciting news. I told some of the board members about this yesterday at the squirrel hunt. But where we were buying the vans from is from another independent Baptist church. It's Mission Baptist. And they're down at Montgomery, off of Montgomery Road. And it's actually Pastor Tim's dad. He's the pastor of that church. And he came to us, heard what we're trying to do, and he said, hey, we're gonna sell you a van because we're getting a new one. And I asked what the price was, and he goes, it'll be a great price for you guys. You guys will be able to afford it. And I said, okay. He texted me this week and said, the van's ready, so we can go and pick it up. And I said, well, how much is it? He goes, it's a little bit more than what I thought it was going to be. And I said, well, what is that price? And he says, it's free. So
Amen.
I'm just saying, I say this all the time. How big is your God? How big is he? You know, when people, when we started this ministry here in Fayetteville, it was just a family and had no idea how we could rent a space, but people kept challenging me saying, how big is your God? How big is he? How big is your God? We had fun at Vacation Bible School and we said that, and then Annette trying to blow us out of the water so the boys would lose and I would get dunked under the water, repeated back to me, what did you say, Annette? What did you say to me? Do you remember?
No.
How big is your God?
How big is your God?
She said, she's like, I don't remember what I said. She said, how big is your God, Bryce? I'm like, my God's pretty big. And we just go around, how big is your God? Is your God this big or is he this big? And you know what? My God that I serve is this big, and he will supply and provide for every single need that you have if you are faithful to him, if you are walking for him. He will say, hey, I see my child right there. Let me show you what I can do through your obedience in church. That is a God that is providing. And so I just want to, on Facebook Live, I just want to thank Pastor Bill Raines and Mission Baptist Church for being obedient to the Lord and serving him and blessing Restorations Ministry. So I just wanted to let you guys know that, and it's great. And so I was on fire and excited about that. So I think, is that, am I missing anything? Is that it? Okay. Eric and Robert said they had a quick announcement, so do you guys need a mic?
No, we'll talk loud.
All right, so as you know, it is Pastor Appreciation Day. And so as a church, we just want you to know how much that we do appreciate you as our pastor and everything that you do for the church. And so we've all, the board, and we've all discussed, and after the service, we want to present you with a check for $500. Just to do what you will with.
Yeah.
So,
praise God. All right. Thank you.
Yep.
Yes.
Thank you, guys.
Yes. We are taking up that special offering, also for which we announced it last week, to do some work on our brother's vehicle, and we actually have a lot of stuff done for Pastor Tim and, man, you guys just make my heart so full. For Pastor Tim and Miss Vicky, and I was there yesterday and we had men working on their vehicle and it's there. We were troubleshooting how to get his wheelchair in there to get him mobile, which was Difficult, I actually had to sit in the wheelchair while Colt was wheeling me in and out, which was, I will be honest, it was really scary. Sometimes I felt like the wheelchair was gonna flip back because I'm a big guy, but I think we have it figured out, and I'm really hoping that we can serve them and just bless them, and we might see them on the next couple Sundays showing up here for serving. And I just want to appreciate the men that were willing to go out and just do the work on the van, be there to troubleshoot, to get Pastor Tim to where he can get into this van and get mobile, because you know, I know you guys haven't met him. You met Vicky and she was here interpreting for us, but he's also my friend, somebody I miss hearing his voice, and he's, I still consider him as my pastor, and you guys willing to serve in that capacity, to serve him, just means more to me than anything, and just what you guys are doing for me and my family, and I appreciate it. I see all these little, I have all these cards up on my pulpit from everybody, all the kids giving me stuff, and it's just, my heart's full, so I can't cry because I won't be able to see my Bible, so let's go ahead and pray. And we'll pray for Pastor Tim and healing. We'll pray for Brother Jerry Berwanger. And just ask for continued growth and healing. And I know with Brother Jerry, his cancer is pretty much, I mean, it's almost eradicated. It's so small, right? And
they said it'll never go away, this like cold.
Yeah.
They said they'll watch for the cold to flare up.
Okay.
And they'll treat it accordingly. But yeah, it's, I mean, I don't think he's going to go back to work. I think he's going to go ahead and take, he done. But,
amen.
Yeah, his cancer, he's learned to appreciate life.
Yes, that's good. Well, we're going to keep on praying for him. Let's go ahead and pray. Father, we love you. And God, we just thank you for who you are. And Lord, we just ask that you just lift up Pastor Tim Raines. We ask that you just heal his body, heal his mind, restore everything, God, so he can rise up out of the chair. Rise up so he can preach and serve you once more, but God, so he can be that husband to his wife, be that father to his daughter. They can hear his voice and just hear him say, I love you, and I appreciate you. God, I want them to hear that so bad, and I just want to see my friend preach again. I want to hear the words that you have used and spoke through him as a vessel, God, and Lord, I know you can restore him, God. I've sat there and I'm teaching and just preaching to my church family, how big is your God? And God, you are so big that I know you can raise Pastor Tim Raines from the chair. I know that you can heal his body. You can restore him, God, fully. You are a God that is capable and fully capable of doing so, Lord. And you have done a miracle in this man's life. And there has been so much and so many miracles that have happened for this man. So many miracles that have happened for this family. You have been there with them through all this heartache, through all the turmoil, Lord. And it's been 3 years, and coming up on that the next week, Lord. 3 years since this accident. But God, you have done amazing things through this accident. People have gotten saved and are swept into the kingdom of heaven because of the accident. Restoration wouldn't exist if it wasn't for what happened to Pastor Tim. There was the ripple effect of what this man and how his reach has gone out, Lord. And I thank you for the man's faithfulness. I thank you for Pastor Tim's reach and just what the family means to me and this church family. And God, we just ask that you be with Brother Jerry Berwanger. And the cancer has gotten so small, the doctors say it'll never go away. But God, again, how big is your God? I know you can eradicate it and take it all away, God. And I ask that you do this in this man's life. And we're going to continue to pray for these two men until we see full restoration in each of their lives. And God, I thank you for my church family. And just, they mean so much to me. And God, my heart's so for it now. And God, I thank you for all the young people and the cards that they gave to me and the love that my church family is showing me and my family. And God, words can't express how much they mean to me. And thank you so much. And in Jesus' name we pray. And I missed my early amen last Sunday. Well, let's go ahead and open your Bibles to the book of Mark. Mark chapter 1. Mark chapter 1. We're going to begin in verse 40. Mark chapter 1 and in verse 40. God's word says this. And there came a leper to him, beseeching him, and kneeling down to him, and saying unto him, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. And Jesus, moved with compassion, put forth his hand and touched him, and saith unto him, I will, be thou clean. And as soon as he had spoken, immediately, there's that word that we've been seeing in this chapter, in this book of Mark, immediately the leprosy departed from him, and he was cleansed. And he straightly charged him, and forthwith sent him away. And he saith unto him, see thou say nothing to any man, but go thy way, show thyself to the priest, and offer for thy cleansing those things which Moses commanded for a testimony unto them. But he went out and began to publish God the matter, and so much that Jesus could no more openly enter into the city, but was without in desert places. And they came to him from every quarter. The title of today's message is A Moving Compassion. And what I want to get out of this is when people are hurting in any way, they might try to seek compassion. But are we as Christians willing to give it? Father, we love you. And God, we thank you for the reading of your word. And God, I just ask that you empty my mind out. Lord, let me be a vessel for you. Fill me with the Holy Spirit so I can feed your sheep today. And Lord, as we look at Mark chapter 1, as we look at these final verses in this chapter, God, I just pray that we as a church family can be moved with compassion for the people that need it. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. And there's my early ameners. Why is it hard to be compassionate today? Would you like to know why? Because you can't trust people. The world is a wicked place, and it's filled with the worst of the worst. God's word says what it's like in the last days. You can see how generation after generation has become more and more selfish, making it hard to do nice things for others. Better yet, to have compassion on others. Compassion is hard to give to other people. You know why? Compassion can make us vulnerable. It can be devastating, and it can even make us look stupid. That's just the truth of it. Compassion is hard to give because of the way the world truly is. Can you turn to 2 Timothy with me? 2 Timothy. Go to 2 Timothy in chapter 3. You want to know how bad the world is and what the world's like? 2 Timothy chapter 3 gives it to us clearly. 2 Timothy chapter 3, we're going to read the first five verses. 2 Timothy chapter 3, this is why it's hard to give compassion to others. This is why when you see somebody hurting and they come to you, you almost don't trust them. When you see somebody homeless on the side of the road, it's like, I'm guilty of this. You drive by it, and what is the first thought that comes to mind? Get a job. There's lots of jobs out there. Get a job. You know, they're probably on drugs. They're probably addicted to alcohol. They're probably, we can just go through the list. When you see somebody else that is just always seems to want handouts, we think, no, we just don't trust anybody anymore. It's so hard to truly trust anybody. And here's why. 2 Timothy chapter 3. We're going to start in verse 1. It says this. This know also that in the last days, perilous times shall come. Boy, we're in the last days, aren't we? You look at some perilous times that we're in right now. For men shall be lovers of their own selves. Can you say that people are selfish? They're lovers of their own selves. Look at this. They're covetous, always wanting what other people have. Boasters, and just boasting about who they are. I've seen that. Proud. I was just talking to Robert about this, that men and women, the reason why marriage is struggles because of ego, and he brings that up a lot, and I'm like, that's true. There's people are had that ego, they're proud. They're blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, Without natural affection, look how many abortions are going on today in the United States. How many unborn babies we've killed because there's not natural affection. Truce breakers.
Whoa.
How many times are people going against their word and saying, hey, I'm going to do this, and then they break that truce with one another? Look at this. False accusers. Has anybody ever been falsely accused of anything? I have. Can I tell you? It ain't fun. It's not fun at all. It's the worst feeling in the world. It hurts to be accused of things. Incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good. Have you ever had that? You're trying to do something good and people just despise you for it. They just think, oh, look at Mr. Holier than thou art. Have you ever had that happen? Sure have. It makes you not want to do anything, doesn't it? It's like, why? What's the point of doing good? What's the point of having compassion on people? Look at this. Traitors. Heedy. High-minded. Lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. The world has sexualized everything. The world has said, hey, this is what needs to happen. You can't watch a commercial without seeing something that involves that. Some type of immorality. And that's what happens. We become lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. You know, you would think if people didn't love the pleasures of life so much that our building would be filled up more because they love God so much that they want to worship Him on the Lord's Day. Now, can we worship God anytime throughout the week? Absolutely, we should. We should always be worshiping God. But He does command us to come together as a people, to lift up our voices, to worship God's word being preached, to have the flock fed, because there's a command in that. But people aren't like that. They're selfish. They're lovers of pleasures. They want what the world has to offer than what God has to offer. Look at this. This last one in verse 5. Having a form of godliness. Man, I've seen that. A form of godliness. That's scary. But denying the power thereof. You know, there's people that will say, yeah, I believe in God. God's there, but He doesn't really care about me. There's a God, but He can't heal that man. There's a God, but He can't do this. There's a God, but He won't take care of me. Let me tell you something. I've got a God that's a very personal God. I have a God that knows every hair that's on my head. It doesn't get any more personal than that. And sometimes I look in the mirror and I think, where is it going? I feel like it's been receding a little bit. I worry about that. You laughing about that, Addie? It's going to happen to any man, all right? Makes me sad.
Looks fine, Addie.
Thank you.
There you go.
Oh, there it is. Who said it? Huh? There it is. Oh, that's a good throw. I'm pretty proud of myself.
How are you proud of that?
Ow, Pastor Bryce hit me in the face. Happy Pastor Appreciation Day. Amen. Look at this last one right here. Having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. So do you understand where the world's at today? Do you understand that there's such wickedness and people are just jerks out there? And do you understand why it's so hard to want to give compassion to somebody? Why it's so hard to want to reach out and be like, man, I see somebody hurting. I'm going to just reach out and touch them just like Jesus did. But you hesitate. You're like, ah, I got burned the last time I did that. It's because of what Timothy was saying in this chapter right here, what Paul was saying to Timothy. This is what people are like in the last day. And let me tell you, we are in the last days. I know a lot of people have said that since before, years and years back in the 60s and 40s, but the last days were signified when Jesus ascended back up into heaven. That's when the last days started, because Jesus could have came back in an hour. The last days started when Jesus went back up into heaven, the Holy Ghost came down and filled that room, and there was the day of Pentecost, and right then, that signified the last days. So since that time, the last days have been around, and it's gotten worse and worse and worse and worse, and it's just bad. Let me ask you this, church. How do we have compassion that moves? You know, Jesus teaches us how we can. It's not easy, nor is it going to be comfortable. Let me ask you some of these questions. What does this compassion look like? What happens if we get burned? Who do we even give it to? Because all of these are very valid questions that I have asked myself, that I've been faced with. And I had to find these answers in God's word. And as I was going through these last verses, God revealed something to me that was so precious. and gave me a deeper understanding of what it means to have a moving compassion. Will you go back to Mark chapter 1 with me in verse 40? Here's the first question I want to ask, and I have it up on the screen. It's, who do we give this compassion to? Look at verse 40 here. Mark chapter 1 and verse 40. And there came a leper to him, beseeching him, and kneeling down to him, and saying unto him, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. You know, I've always heard about lepers, and you have heard, has anybody not heard about leprosy? Leprosy is kind of a disease, and a lot of people today, in today's world, society, a lot of third world countries get leprosy. And the way leprosy starts, and I actually researched this, and I was kind of grossed out, so young people and kids, I'm sorry, but this is God's word, so. But leprosy starts with little red dots, like little red circles all over your body. And then those circles get a little bigger. And then those circles turn white. And I'm like, ew, that's kind of gross. And then your fingernails, which mine are kind of dirty, I was working on Deidre's car and broke it, so. Then your fingernails and toenails start to shrink and start to fall off. Isn't that crazy? It's like, ugh, all right? Then your joints start to ache and your joints begin to rot, and where your fingers are at on your joints begin to fall off.
Yeah.
And then you start, your teeth begin to start falling out because your gums start to recede because they're rotting away and there's nothing for your teeth to hold on to, so your teeth begin to fall out. And then eventually, it works its way to your eyes, and your eyes begin to rot, and your eyes will fall out of your head, and you continue to rot away from the inside out until you die. That is what leprosy is. Now, I want you to look at this.
Are we able to stop it?
There's no medicine
cure
that'll stop leprosy. And let me tell you something. This is interesting, too. In God's word, and I looked this up, there were some people in the Old Testament that were healed of leprosy because God healed them, but all of them were not anybody from Israel. There was one person, but they didn't have, it was actually Miriam when Moses was out, and they contracted leprosy. They put her out of the city, and then 7 days she came back and she was healed. But as far as that, nobody else was ever healed from leprosy up until Jesus came here. And you have this leper that is coming to Jesus, and it says, and there came a leper to him. Now think about what a leper is. This man had nothing left. Can you imagine what this guy looked like? And then back in Israel, when somebody had leprosy, they weren't allowed around anybody else. Did you know that? They had to cover up their head, and they had to go around saying, unclean! I'm unclean! Walking around. So people could see it, and they avoided this person. So now you have this leper. Do you understand what leprosy is? And what this man was going through? Nobody wanted him. Nobody wanted anything to do with him. He was considered the living dead. The living dead. That's what they called him. And so this man now, there came a leper to him, beseeching him, and kneeling down to him, and saying unto him, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. This leper had nothing. Nothing. This leper was getting ready to die. He knew his time was drawing near. He knew nobody wanted anything to do with him, but yet he came to Jesus breaking the law. Think about that. The law commanded him to cover himself up and to avoid everybody and to scream unclean, but this leper came and kneeled down at Jesus' feet and just said, hey, if you will, I know you can make me clean. He didn't want to be healed. He wanted to be cleansed and made clean. So I asked this, who do we give this compassion to? We give it to anybody that is seeking compassion. When somebody dirty is coming to you, or is presented to you, or that is rejects of society, they're like, I don't want anything to do with that. You need to go to them. I've been running at the park in Fayetteville lately. And One day I went to go stretch in the picnic area where we first had our church services, and I had Toby with me, our dog, and I was just, had my leg up on a picnic table, and I'm just stretching, and I let him off the leash because I have him tied to me, and he's over there, and he's acting real funny. He gets down, and his hair's standing up, and he's just growling, and I'm like looking over in the bushes, in the tree line, it's still dark, I can't really see, and I'm like, Toby, would you shut up? Like, what's wrong? And he was just bothering me. I'm sitting there trying to stretch, and he would not unlock his eyes from whatever he was looking at. I couldn't see anything. And then I'm like, what is he looking at? And then I saw this shape, a really big shape, and my heart jumped up, and it scared me to death. And I'm like, what kind of animal is that? And I'm like, oh, man, I'm going to die. I almost took off running and said, Toby, good luck, and just ran. And but then I looked, and I saw it, and it was a person. And I was like, that's a homeless person. And I'll just be honest, I've walked around downtown Cincinnati, but I've never actually been around somebody that was struggling and homeless. And this person's just laying there, and I just wanted to make sure that he was still breathing. So I like walked over, and I got about as close as I could get this, and I could just touch your cheek. I didn't touch him, and I'm like, okay, he's breathing, okay, I'm good. And I just walked away. And I got in my car, and I started driving. And then I started thinking about a Bible verse that we just studied recently about, if you do unto these, unto the least of these, you've done it unto me. And I was like, man, for some reason, I just started crying. And I started reading this, and I started thinking about, man, that man was like a leper of society. Somebody that he didn't come to me asking for cleansing or for forgiveness or anything like that, or just compassion. He wasn't asking for any of that. He was just sleeping. But yet he was brought to my attention. And I said, man, I should have done something, and I didn't. So you know what I started doing? I started praying. I said, God, I said, if it's your will, bring that man back to that park again. And if he's there, I want to share the gospel with him. And it took about 4 days. You know what? He was there again, but this time he was walking around. And I started running, and I could hear him because he sounded like he was possessed with the devil. He was and just growling and moving, and I was running, and it's dark. And let me tell you, church, I was scared. I'm a big guy. You guys think I'm a big guy? All right. I don't know if I can handle myself, but I do pretty well in some sports, but I could probably run away pretty fast. All right. But I'm a big guy, and this person was not big, just kind of frail. And I was going around, and I just kept running. And then as I passed him again, I just heard the growling. And I said, God, I know you want me to present the gospel. You brought him before me again, but I am scared. I didn't want to. I feared for my life. What if he had a knife? What if he's messed up that he pulled a knife on me and he stabbed me? Think about that. What if something happened that I got some type of disease? If he had some type of disease that he contracted and he spit on me or something, and then I get sick and have something that's permanent? Those are thoughts that go through anybody's head, especially with homeless people. You don't know where anybody has been. And these are things that were running through my mind as I'm running around this track. And I said, God, I can't. And I was like, I said, okay. And I started running, and then I slowed down when I was getting back around, and I stopped. And I went back to my car, and I grabbed my Bible, and I started walking over there. And as soon as I got to him, it just stopped. And I was able to open God's word up, and I shared the gospel. He said he was saved. I asked him what his name was, and I invited him to church. But can I tell you, I was scared to death. Being compassionate to somebody that you don't know, that needs it, is scary. But those are the people that need this compassion that is moving. Who do we give this compassion to? The ones that nobody's willing to go to. That's who needs it. But secondly, I want to look at this morning, what does this compassion look like? Look at verse 41 here. In Mark chapter 1, verse 41, God's word says this: and Jesus, moved with compassion, put forth his hand and touched him and saith unto him, I will, be thou clean. You see, Jesus was moved with compassion, and he touched him and made him clean. You know, this compassion, what does it look like? It needs to have action behind it. It needs to be personal. It needs to meet the very person's need. And it should be something that's intimate. You know, this leper comes to Jesus. Nobody wants to touch this person. Can I tell you, this leper probably hasn't had the personal touch of somebody just going, hey, how you doing? How you doing? He probably hasn't had a handshake, a hug, nothing for years. Can you imagine that? Not having the human touch for years? Not having anybody want to reach out and just give you a hug when you're having a hard time? He is by himself and has nothing. He has no one. And he goes to Jesus and sits down at his feet. And what does it say that Jesus did? Does it say that he looked at him, was moved with compassion, and says, okay, be thou clean, stand up and rise and go? Could Jesus have spoken it and he would have been healed? Church, could he have? Absolutely he could have. He did the same thing. He spoke and talked to the centurion and said, there's been no greater faith found in all of Israel than this centurion, because the centurion went to Jesus and said, come heal my servant. And he said, all right, I'm going to come. And he goes, no, you don't even need to come with me. Speak the words and he'll be healed. And Jesus was like, man, I haven't found so great a faith in all of Israel that you believe that I can just speak it and he's healed. And he says, go home in the very same hour. That servant, that person is going to be healed. And he went home and he was healed. Jesus could have spoken, but Jesus didn't do that with this leper. What does it say that he did? Let's look. I want to read it out loud. And Jesus moved with compassion. What does it say? Say these four words with me, church. Put forth his hand. He didn't sit there like this. He put forth his hand. And what's the next statement right here? He put forth his hand. And what does it say? These three words. And touched him. Can you imagine what this leper was probably feeling right then? Somebody touched me. Oh, haven't had anybody touch me in forever. Nobody's given me a hug, a handshake, a pat on the back. But Jesus put forth his hand and he put it right on this leper that was filthy and dirty. And he didn't get healed before he touched him. He touched him first. He met his very need. It was intimate. And then Jesus says to him, I will, be thou clean. And all of a sudden, instantaneously, this guy was clean. Church, there's a need that people have, compassion. Now, I know we're talking about, there can be rejects out in society, but can I be bold as to say this? When you go to your workplace, are there not people that you just don't want to be around? Can I just be honest? Are there people that you don't want to be around? Yep. Why is that? You know why? Because they might be annoying. They're just a pest. You think that they might be an idiot because of what they're doing with their job, and you're like, I just don't want anything to do with this person. I just can't stand being around them. They annoy me, and yeah, I know I'm called to love them, but I just don't want to be near them. But can I tell you, people want acceptance. People want compassion. People want friendship. People want a personal touch. But yet we're unwilling as Christians to give it to anybody. Can I tell you, it happens in churches. I was in youth group at Eastgate Baptist, and I was there for all of my youth. And there was a guy that was there that was, man, he was annoying. And he would come in, and he would be kind of proud, boastful, and just, it was hard to be his friend because of the way that he always acted. And nobody wanted to be around him. His older sibling, people wanted to be around. His younger sister was different, but people wanted to be around her. But there was just something about this guy that nobody wanted anything to do with him. Nobody wanted to be around him. In church, I'm guilty that I kind of stayed to myself, and I kind of stayed in the corner by myself anyways, with just like a select few people, because some people just scared me. But nobody wanted to be this guy's friend. And as I've gotten older, I look back at that moment of, man, would this young man's life have been changed if I just would have put my hand forward and touched him? Said, hey man, how you doing? You want to go see a movie with me? You want to come over and hang out and play some video games or go do something else and just change his life? Being in school, there's kids that nobody wants to be around. You guys know that. There's the smelly kids, all right? I was one of the chubby kids that was like, ah, that's Bryce. I didn't get picked on a whole lot in high school because my dad's a barber. And so he cut a lot of the jocks' hairs, like all the football players. So nobody ever really messed with me, which is fine because I was very quiet and timid in high school. If you can believe that or not, I was shy, okay? But there are people that need that personal touch in our lives. Going back to the gentleman that I saw in the park, when I had the opportunity to pray with him, I was a little scared. I told you that. Actually, I wasn't a little bit, I was a lot scared. But I remember I was sitting there and I thought, I want to pray with this guy. And I reached out and I touched him. And I prayed with him. And let me tell you something. I didn't get sick. I didn't get bit. I didn't get stabbed. Nothing happened. You know what happened? He just closed his eyes and prayed with me. And then when I got done praying with him, would you like to know what he did? He put his hand forward like this and said, man, I really appreciate that. And I got the opportunity and I just shook his hand and said, hey, we're right down the street, Restoration. There's a strip mall. Why don't you come join us on Sunday? I said, come down and just, God's people are there. You'll be welcome then. Just come on down. And I haven't seen him. I don't know what has happened to him. He could have been an angel unaware. I have no idea. That would be pretty awesome, wouldn't it? If he was an angel unaware, woo, that would be pretty sweet. But we have to put forth that effort with anybody that needs that compassion. People get, there's a big thing going on, and it's been around, but it just seems like it's gotten worse with bullying. Would you guys agree with that?
Yes.
In school, bullying, yes. Addie, you're like, yes, she's in school, so she's, yes, bullying is bad. You know why people get bullied? Is because they're the rejects of that society and nobody wants anything to do with them. That's why. People are just mean. They're like, I don't want anything to do with that. People were mean to this leper. Nobody wanted anything to do with him. And by law, he had to stay away. But yet, Jesus personally touched him and personally met his needs. Whose needs need to be personally met? Because you need to have compassion for them. But a compassion that moves. A compassion that's pushed to action. It is really easy to say, oh man, I saw somebody, it touched my heart, but I drove away and I prayed for that person. Have you guys ever done that? You pray for a person, you're like, oh, I thought about him, I saw him. Lord, just be with that person, meet their every need, just help them, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Okay, I feel good because I prayed about the person, but Jesus is sitting there like, you idiot, you're the person that can meet their needs. You're the person that can turn around and touch them. You're the person that can go around. I'm sorry, I got really close to Facebook Live. You're the person that can go around and help wherever they need that help at. But you don't do it. Why? Because of what we've read in 2 Timothy. Because we're scared to put ourselves out there. We're scared to give that compassion because we don't know what's going to happen. Then, lastly, what happens? Look at this. I can tell you why, at times, people withdraw from wanting to give this moving compassion that Jesus gave. Look at this last question. What happens if we get burned by this compassion? Have you ever tried giving compassion to somebody and you got burned?
What does that mean?
Get burned? Yes. That means that it blows up in your face. You try to help somebody and then they just throw it back in your face, or you get hurt, or somebody yells at you because you tried to do something, or just anything could happen. Murphy's Law, what can't go wrong will go wrong. You try to do something nice and then it just blows up in your face. You're like, I was just trying to do something nice for the person and just bad stuff happened. Has anybody gotten burned? I have gotten burned. And you know what? It is not fun. You serve people in a church and you try to show compassion to people and guess what? It blows up in your face. Now, it hasn't happened here, so praise the Lord for that. I love you guys. But I've been in ministry for quite a while and I've experienced it, and it is not fun at all. I'm sure you've experienced this in your own life, getting burned, trying to show that compassion. But look at what Jesus did. Look at verse 43. We're going to read verses 43 through 45. It says this, and straightly charged him, and forthwith sent him away, and saith unto him, see thou say nothing to any man. Isn't it interesting that Jesus heals this guy, heals his leprosy, he's fully restored, but then he says, hey, you say nothing to anybody about this. Can I tell you that it was just him and Jesus standing there? Nobody else. His disciples weren't there. His disciples didn't see what was going on. There was no crowd around him. The crowd couldn't see what was going on. It was this leper and Jesus. And he said, don't you dare tell anybody. You don't tell anybody about this. And he says this. He says, but go thy way, show thyself to the priest, and offer for thy cleansing those things which Moses commanded for a testimony unto them. Jesus is the Son of God that cleansed this man But yet he charges him to say nothing. But you know why? Because he wanted to give the Heavenly Father glory and saying, hey, go to the priest as a witness. And if this man would have went to the priest, they knew who this guy was. And he said, I have been healed of my leprosy. There are sacrifices that need to be made unto God that these priests have never performed. Because nobody's ever been healed from leprosy before. Think about that. In all of Israel, they've never had to perform this sacrifice. And if this man goes to these priests and says, man, I've been healed of my leprosy, and they're like, what is going on? How did you get healed? God healed me. And then these priests are like, well, what do we have to do? And they're probably like trying to find out in their law, like, what kind of sacrifice are we supposed to do for this? We've never done this before. This is different. God has never healed this leprosy. Now, in the Old Testament, there was King Naaman, I believe is what his name was, but he was a Syrian. He was not of Israel. There have been people in the Old Testament that, yes, they had been healed of leprosy, but never in all of Israel. Whew. This is something different. Because only God can cleanse leprosy. But you see, he told this man to go and be a testimony unto the Lord. This was something that was supposed to build God up and say, hey, look what God has done. And to get these priests thinking, wow, this is amazing. Look at what God is doing. But what did this guy do? I'm sure he had good intentions. But this kind of blew up in Jesus' face. Look at verse 45. But he went out and began to publish it much and to blaze abroad the matter. And so much that Jesus could no more openly enter into the city, but was without in desert places. And they came to him from every quarter. See, Jesus did not want this man to be boasting about this because Jesus needed to go from city to city. We learned that last week that his job was to go from here to here to here to be preaching God's word, but yet he sees this single person and had compassion. And Jesus knew, Jesus is God. Jesus knew that this man was going to go blazing abroad. Jesus knew that this guy was going to go out and mess things up, but he still said, go forth, you're clean, and I need you to do this. Go and be a testimony unto the Lord. But yet, this guy didn't obey. This guy had good intentions. This man was like, hey, man, this Jesus healed me. I am cleansed of my leprosy. I am no longer the living dead, but I'm walking about alive. And I am full of life now, and I can be touched by people, and I can serve people, and now I can have a family, and I can do things that I would have never been able to do before. That's what this man was excited about. I would have been excited. I would have been like, you know, like, woo, and like took off running and just been excited and just been to say, Jesus healed me. I have been healed. He is amazing. I would have been just like this guy, but this man still disobeyed. Because he went out and began to publish it much, and to blaze abroad the matter, and so much that Jesus could no more openly enter into the city. You see, this man had those good intentions. But good intentions can still hurt. But what I love about Jesus is that even though he knew this man was going to do it, even though he knew that this was going to blow up in his face and cause issues, he still healed and cleansed the leper. Church, no matter who you're having compassion towards and who you're reaching forth to touch, it may blow up in your face. They may throw something back at you. They may say, you know, I'm not some charity case, or like, I don't need your love and compassion. I don't need any of this. Why are you coming to me like this? Because they've never had anybody come to them before, and it could blow up in your face. Many times it actually might. But if we're following after Jesus' example, does it matter? No, it sure doesn't. If we are to be just like Jesus, we need to reach out and touch the ones that need that compassion. We need to have a moving compassion, a compassion that is called to action, a compassion that shows the love of God, that shows it doesn't matter how dirty you think you are, you can be cleansed. It doesn't matter where you think you're at in life, you can still be cleansed. It doesn't matter if you think that you're this living dead, the walking dead is basically what he felt like. You know what? You can be clean. Church, are you willing to go out? We have Fayetteville. And we talked about this, that, and I think it was a surprise to some people when I said, I think there's, you know, there's, another pastor told me that there's actually a prostitution ring out here. You know, like, oh, prostitution out in Fayetteville? It's like, yeah, there's prostitution out here in Fayetteville. And I asked this guy, I was like, well, how do you know? And he said, I still got my ear to the ground. This guy used to be a lieutenant in the Aryan Brotherhood. He knows. I actually just saw something where this man went to a gala and preached at this, it was called Scarlet Hope, which is a ministry to get women out of these industries and back into society. How wonderful is that? If you saw somebody that was on drugs, are you willing to have a moving compassion, go up to them and be like, hey, what can I do for you? If you saw somebody that was struggling with alcohol and you know they're a complete drunk and they smell and stink, are you willing to go up to them and say, hey, how can I pray for you? If you know somebody is just crazy, you're like, man, that's a crazy person. Are you willing to go forward and say, hey, do you know who Jesus Christ is? Are there people at your work that are hurting and aching that you can walk forward and say, hey, how are you doing? How can I help you? I want to be your friend today. You put your hand on them and just say, what can I do for you? Hey, what about your church family? Is there somebody here at church that needs that hand reached out to them that's just hurting? And they're just crying out saying, man, I wish somebody would just have compassion towards me, but I'm not finding it anywhere. So people will show up to church wanting compassion. They want to be loved. They want that outreached hand, but yet there's all these closed hands. There's all these hands that are doing this saying, I can't. I got my own family to worry about. I got my own kids to worry about. Nobody's wanting to open their hands up and reach out and just touch somebody like Jesus did. Can you imagine the change that could happen in our town if every single person in this room, including myself, went out there just to help somebody with a moving compassion? Not expecting, hey, come to church now. It's not about that. It's just going out like Jesus did. And when you see them and they're coming and just needing this, you're like, okay, rise up, you're cleansed, you're healed. People need to have that healing power. And the only way they can have that healing power is by somebody showing that love of Christ to them. Because when that love of Christ is shown to them, church, just like Jesus said, if you do unto the least of these, you've done unto me. Our theme for the year, which I've done, I apologize, church. I've done a bad job as a pastor. Like, it's Pastor Appreciation Day. No, I've done a bad job at bringing things back to our theme. I see it now when I'm preaching, and I can see all the writings on the wall. Decisions that people said, this is what I want to do, because our theme is, I love Jesus enough to. Enough to do what? How much do you love Jesus? If you do unto the least of these, you've done unto me. That's what you're doing for Jesus. When you show compassion to others, you're doing it to him. You're doing it to your Savior. You're doing it to the one that went to the cross for you, because Jesus went to the cross because he had compassion for you and me. Amen? I get excited about that. When I think about that compassion, that should move you to do something great. That should move you to want to reach out to people. But yet we get scared. What if I get rejected? What if I get someone blows up at me? It doesn't matter, church. Reach out. How much do you love Jesus? I love Jesus enough to, and there's all these things over there. You know how much I love Jesus? I love Jesus enough to reach out and touch somebody that I was scared to death about. And it wasn't that scary. You can do it. You just have to reach out and be obedient and touch them. You'll be amazed about what God can do through that obedience. I'll say this again. How big is your God? Something for God. Your compassion for others and your love for others and reaching out to them can change their life. Never forget that. When you're in
in school with those all your friends and you see all these kids running around and you see somebody by themselves, guess what? Have a moving compassion to go talk to him or her. Say, hey, would you like to be my friend? And that'll change their life forever. When you're going around the innocence of a child, you know, from a child's mouth, and you learn so much, and I love that Addie can reach out and see that way, because you know what? She's saved. And I wish we could be more like kids growing up and have a compassion for others that's just, it's so innocent and just giving to everybody, isn't it? I love that. But as we get older, we become hardened. Our hearts get hardened. We just say, well, this is the way society is, and this is what I'm going to do. But if we look back to Scripture and what Jesus did, it blew up in his face, it messed up, he couldn't openly go into the cities anymore. But yet he still continued doing what he did all the way to Calvary. Can we have every head bowed and every eye closed? The praise team can start making their way forward. We're talking about this moving compassion. A compassion that is supposed to be deeply rooted in our Christian walk with God, because compassion is so important in our relationship. If we look at who Jesus Christ is and what he did here on this earth, he had a moving compassion for everybody. Jesus Christ had a moving compassion when he went to the cross. Jesus Christ went to that cross for you and me. Jesus said, this is what we need to do. He wants us to be the hands and feet of who he is. Nobody else is capable of going out except for you to touch these people that need to be touched and helped and loved and shown this compassion, because it can change their life forever. I want to ask you this, church. How much do you love Jesus? Do you love him enough to have a moving compassion for others? I know I do. And I love him enough to have a moving compassion. I love him enough to go outside the box of what I think church is, and go outside the box of who I think should come to church, and start reaching out to these people that need Jesus Christ. Will you join me in this compassion? Will you join me in this, what Jesus is teaching to change somebody? I can't make you. Nobody can make you. You can let this fall on deaf ears. You can let this message of having compassion just be left here at the door, and you know, walk out and say, you know what? That was okay, but I'm going to go about my day and go about my life, and this is what's going to happen. Come back next week and hear a different message and a different message and a different message, and nothing else really matters. Or will you allow this to touch your heart? Will you allow it to change your life so you can change the life of somebody else that needs it? If you are saved and born again, you have the compassion inside, but you need to be obedient and to serve God. God's message spoke to your heart today, and you want to have that moving compassion. Maybe you just don't know how. Maybe you need to bring it up here before the Lord and pray about it. When you come forward to pray about something, you know what that does? That solidifies what God has placed on your heart. You can pray right there in your seats, but when you're bold and you walk forward and say, hey, Bryce, I want you to pray with me about this, guess what? I will pray with you right here at the altar about having that moving compassion and letting God open a door up for you, praying about that. But maybe God's speaking to you in a different way. Maybe you're here today and you're like, you know what, Bryce? This compassion sounds good, but I don't know who this Jesus Christ guy is. I mean, I've heard about Jesus, but, you know, what do you mean he went to the cross for me and you? Well, let me tell you something. If you've never asked Jesus into your heart, you should be a little scared. Because if you've never asked Jesus Christ into your heart, you're going to this place called hell. If you don't want to go to this place called hell, there's three things that you need to do. It's the three-step process. You guys ready for this? Number one, you got to accept who you are. You're a sinner. You deserve hell. You were born a sinner because of Adam. The Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So you must accept who you are. But secondly, you need to accept who Jesus is. Jesus Christ came to this earth, born of a virgin, grew and lived a sinless, perfect life. And because of compassion that was moving, went to the cross for you and me. He died on that cross, went to the grave, and rose again in 3 days, taking the keys to death and hell. So you must accept who you are, a sinner, hellbound, accept who Jesus is, the one that came here to cover that sin, the ultimate sacrifice. But here's the third thing you must do. You must ask. You must ask Jesus to come into your heart and save you. The Bible says in Romans chapter 10, with the mouth man confesseth, but with the heart he believeth unto righteousness. That if thou confess the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that he raised him from the dead, the Bible says thou shalt be saved. Right there in your seat, you can ask Jesus into your heart. Right there in your seat, you can believe with everything you are and understand the compassion that Jesus had on the cross, because that compassion can fill your heart and that compassion can cause you to have compassion for others. But it's up to you to ask. It's up to you to move. We're going to pray. And if you ask Jesus into your heart, I want you to come up here and say, Bryce, I just got saved and I asked Jesus Christ into my heart. If you are saying, Bryce, this message is convicting my heart, and hey, I want to have a more moving compassion. I want to love others the way that Jesus just did for this leper. Come forward and say, I want to do this, and I'll pray with you that God just opens up a door for you. But make sure your heart is right before we start singing our praises to Him. We're going to be singing to God. We're going to be lifting up our voices and our hearts to Him, and we need to be right. Father, we love you. And God, we thank you for who you are, what you've done for us. And God, I just thank you for this moving compassion, what you did for this leper, this man that was riding from the inside out. And God, you touched him. You gave him the loving touch. You gave him a compassion that nobody else would give. And Lord, I pray that my church family and myself will love you enough to do exactly what you did for this man and show a moving compassion to the people that need it. If there's somebody here that has never accepted your son, Jesus Christ, as their Savior, I pray today they will make it right. In your son's holy name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and lift our voices up to God. If God is laying something on your heart, a decision that needs to be made, the stage is open. You can pray up here. You can pray in your seat. But get right with the Lord.
Thank you.
let's go ahead and we'll sing our next, or is there a special that's happening? Okay, not yet. I think we have a special today, don't we? Okay, we do.
Thank you.
then Miss Brittany is going to come up and sing a special for us.
Thank you. Thank you.
let's go ahead and stand one more time. One more time, we're gonna sing a hymn. We're gonna sing hymn number 309. 309. 309. Christ is our advocate, and I will be the same for you. I will be there, love you, and meet you where you're at. So just know that I will always be in your corner. I don't care who you are, I will always be there for you. So we're going to end the same way we end every Sunday, and I pray that you love Jesus enough to be compassionate and having that moving compassion. Tori, will you have a moving compassion? I guess, you know, if the mood strikes her, all right? If the mood strikes you, I'm just kidding, I'm just playing. Jack, you gonna have moving compassion? Tina, you gonna have moving compassion? Yes, she is. Miss Kay, you gonna have moving compassion?
Yes, she is. All right, so just like James says, he says, don't be just what?
Hearers.
He says, be?
Doers.
A move of compassion. You are dismissed.
Thank you.